cons, it's, I don't know if Ashley even announced, but it's fine.
She did.
Oh, did she? Okay, what did she announce about us?
Just the regular thing.
Mark is gonna mess up our panel meetings, it's a whole thing, it made me laugh for a really long time, so it was all good. But it was originally a body positivity in cosplay, but it's kind of evolved into just overcoming any type of challenges. I have a lot of anxiety, but I'm also, I have some medical problems, I've put on a decent amount of weight, and I was not body positive when I started cosplaying, and I mean, cosplay really is for everyone. I mean, one of the quotes that I like to pull out, I'm so not prepared for this, there's a, I'll paraphrase it, one of my first cosplays was like Belladonna from Ruby. I don't know how many people here are familiar. I was her volume 7 on Friday. But her alternate volume 2 costume was my first costume. And it's supposed to be a midriff top, her jacket. And I was not comfortable, so I did it kind of more of a, you know, down to my waist. And when I was starting to make that cosplay, I found this quote by Miles Luna, and he basically said, you know, a black person can cosplay, you know, you can cosplay Blake if you're black, you can cosplay Blake if you're skinny, you can cosplay Blake if you're fat, you can cosplay Blake, you know, whatever. Just not if you're hateful to other people, you know, like, that is not what she's about, that's not what cosplay is about, and just being, you know, a positive force in the community, which, not to embarrass you, but these two have been, we also run the cosplay contests and stuff for QuadCon, and these two have been a wonderful positive addition, and just the fact that they're here to support us, I mean, we appreciate you guys so much. That's what it's all about. You know, anybody can cosplay. I mean, it really is for everyone. I mean, you know, whatever your limitations are, whether it's physical, whether it's mental. You know, I've seen so many people incorporate their physical disabilities into a cosplay. I met a girl at Wizard World, I think, Chicago, that had a port for insulin. And she incorporated it into her cosplay. I met some people at C2E2 that do wheelchairs. And they make them for people who want to cosplay.
There's a Tron bike, and this is over the wheelchair, and so he wore the Tron suit, and then the Tron bike went over the wheelchair, so he could still get around and still move the wheelchair, and it looked like he was riding the bike.
I follow a girl on Instagram who is Muslim and wears a hijab, and she incorporates them into her cosplay. That's just, instead of a wig, she has different colors. I mean, it's just fantastic. I love seeing that stuff. I love seeing, you know, he does a gender bend yang. You know, that's such a, putting your own touches on a cosplay. I mean, if you want to cosplay something screen accurate, wonderful. I am such a perfectionist that I hate that things like, this was kind of a, I don't have a lot of money, what can I do with my own hair color thing for Last Planet Funk. And Vanellope has been a fan favorite. And I honestly love her, she's my comfy cosplay. But to be honest, there are some times that I'm like, well, it doesn't look exactly like that. Or with Blake too, and I'm like, he's like, they're cartoon characters. You're human. Their body can do whatever because it's a cartoon character. So I like to do some original characters sometimes. Yesterday I was a Slytherin student because I can wear my glasses. I can have my hair however, you know. But, you know, just do you. And I don't know, you're usually more about how you got into cosplay.
As far as the journey into getting into cosplay and stuff like that, and positivity and stuff like that, she can attest, but very early on in my cosplay career was almost done before it started. So getting into cosplay, I knew that it was a thing starting off. I had always followed and seen, like, I don't know, you know, Jessica Drew, Yaya Han, like the big names. I knew about them. I knew that cosplay existed. I just always figured it was a high tier thing. You know, they're models. These are professionals. This is things that they get paid to do. I'm not in that, so I'm not doing it. And then a friend of mine drugged me to in Des Moines after passing through that first year. And we got to the show floor, and I was just wearing a t-shirt. I started looking around, and I saw everybody in cosplay. I was like, these are not professionals. These are just people. Like, anybody can do this. Why the hell have I not been doing this? And so, came back, decided that the first one that I was going to do was Riddler, which this is like, fourth generation Riddler. Like, he's undergone a lot of transformations. But the first generation Riddler, I had never sewn, I'd never patterned, I'd never done anything. I literally had no idea where to start. I just knew I was getting into it somehow.
Okay, I'm going to interject here real quick. So he frustrates the hell out of me. I love you. But in 2016, I asked him where he went for his birthday, and he said a sewing machine. I would have one in storage. You don't need to, I can get you something else. Here's my sewing machine. Taught him how to pattern the best. I have sewn off and on since I was about 9. Not a wonderful seamstress by any means. I can sew. He says that my skills are better than I think they are, and I like to make my own stuff. He's gone from me teaching him how to pin that pattern. He is 100% self-taught. Master's Craft for Des Moines. You won at Funk last time, video game.
First place in the video game.
So go ahead. Sorry, I was just...
Yes. The premise is, once I got the sewing machine, once I got started, I literally, all I made was a vest. Started super simple, super easy, everything. I made the vest, and I had like one little question mark on the back, and that was it. I'm a manager with IB. Outside of all of this. And so I wore my black work pants, I wore a purple button-down work shirt and everything. Like, I basically was just in my work uniform with this vest on top. And I went to it, and I can't tell you how many people were like, oh, nice Joker cosplay. Thank you. After like the fourth or fifth person, I was just like, I'm not even fighting it anymore.
Honestly, that's another thing, whatever. Though. I will say, I'm sorry, I interject way too much, but my first cosplay was a Sith, my silver sometimes, and it's undergone a lot of things, but I bought a lights Elder Saber at my first Wizard World Chicago, and I decided I was going to make my first cosplay and he held, but I was at the, it was Des Moines Wizard World, and I felt like nobody cared about my costume, but there were some wonderful cosplayers there that were so supportive, and honestly, that's what made me keep cosplaying. But this kid ran up to me, we were packing away our stuff before going over the con that Sunday, and he's like, nice ninja costume, and I'm like, thanks! I mean, I feel like that's just kind of what you do, but anyway. People say Joker, and you've got question marks like everywhere.
Yeah, I don't. It's the same people that ask if they can copy friends if you make copies. I still get that. Anyways, so one of the first conventions that I went to after starting cosplay was Wizard of Chicago. And I met several cosplayers there that were super nice and everybody was super welcoming. And then I started talking to some of the guests and a couple of guest cosplayers. And for certain reasons, one of them I'm pretty sure doesn't really do cosplay anymore, but I'm not going to name names just because I don't want people to have those negative opinions and others and everything. But suffice it to say, there was specifically one, but even a couple of guests that really were very dismissive with the questions that I had. They really couldn't care less about what I had to ask or what I wanted to know or anything like that. And they really didn't. They were basically just not supportive of the show. They couldn't care less because I wasn't giving them money. I wasn't giving them, subscriptions or whatever it was that they were there for, and so they just didn't care. And I, having just started, and then to basically be just kind of pushed off to the side like that, it was very disheartening for me. And I thought about just like, well, I guess if these are the people that are doing it, and those are the people that are getting paid to do it, obviously they know what they're doing, and I'm probably not really all that great at it and everything, so maybe I really shouldn't be investing my time and money into this. And I'm glad that I did. I'm glad that I stuck with it. I'm glad that I have friends. Sarah, my other friend Neil, who was the one who drove me to the Wizard of Oz in the first place, they encouraged me to kind of keep going and just kind of keep pushing it. And I did. And it's sore. There's ups and downs like anything else. But, you know, I'm so glad that I did, because I have met so many fantastic people and I've had so many wonderful experiences just from doing this. And just dressing up and being a nerd.
Well,
and the ability to do that is so fantastic.
Honestly, there are so many more great people than there are bad people. It's honestly kind of sad that Mogshaw was supposed to be a guest this weekend and had a family emergency, and she's actually part of why both of us have cosplay. She is a fantastic person, and she, after Josh had those couple of bad experiences, he found Casey and Mog, and they were like, "Oh, what do you want to know? And what, you know, what can we help you with?" And Mog was at that first Wizard World I went to in Des Moines too, and I said, "Oh, I'm so happy to meet you. You know, Josh has told me how." Sorry, I'm a little emotional all the time. I'm a crier. And you know, I said, "It's so great to meet you." And he was her judge's pick, and she invited us out to Zombie Burger with the professional cosplayers, and once again, yeah, he was so sick. But they have, most of them have become actually friends. Sabrina Baroness cosplay, she, Maris Bunty, she was downstairs. She has, you know, was so supportive. Papa Bear, another fantastic cosplayer out of Chicago, if you guys follow people, you know, he's one to follow. He was such a supportive, wonderful person. Outplay Lake, she is I guess she does not do her Twitch channel anymore, but she is such a huge Instagram presence, was such a huge Twitch, you know, streamer, and I was talking to her, and she's like, "I don't know why some of these cosplayers on Instagram get Instagram famous and think that they are all that." And I am like, "You are beautiful and talented and you are so down to earth, and you are telling us," like, she's looking at, you know, the stitches that, you know, we've done and stuff, and she's like, "Okay, if you're wanting to get into competition, here's, you know, what you can do," and, you know, just giving us these wonderful tips, and just, they were so wonderful and supportive. And then my first C2E2, I came in Blake, and he was in Ike. We should have brought pictures, honestly, but so Ike is actually what he won Planet Funk video games last time. It's 100% him, other than like the boots and the wig. He made everything. He did all the foam work, the armor, he did all the swimming, and everybody was impressed, and we couldn't go like five steps without somebody being like, "Hey, can I get a picture?" And it was only my second con in cosplay. And I went and I sat down to a panel. And I was just kind of sitting there waiting for the panel to start. And this kid came up, I was probably early 20s, and he was like, "Oh, excuse me." And I thought I was in his way. And I went kind of like to push my chair back, and I'm like, "Oh, I'm sorry." And he's like, and I'm like, "Want my picture?" I'm like, "Oh, sure." And then like so many more. So Des Moines was just kind of a different feel that first year. And my cosplay was very generic. If you are dressed, honestly, my stuff did really well there too. C2E2 is such more of a cosplay con too. Somebody will always recognize your character for the most part. I mean, there's always going to be that one person, no matter how niche your cosplay is, that's like, "Oh my god, are you that character? That's my favorite character," you know, and it just makes you feel so good. And it's just that that connection with other people. I mean,
no matter how many question marks you have.
Yeah, well, you know, it's a nice joke at cosplay. But no, I mean, it's like I said, this is kind of an informal panel. I mean, I don't know if you've got more to add. I'm gonna say I have a lot of anxiety. You know, I do sometimes feel very overwhelmed at cons, and I feel like having so many people that I know helps, but also, you know, last Planet Funk, there was Thousand Faces cosplay Luna there, and Lauren, the female half, their duo, they're a married couple, actually ran a panel about anxiety, and she just had a lot of great tips. And to be honest, you know, you gotta do what you have to do too. I mean, if you need to ground yourself, you know, do your, you know, touch, you know, your senses. I'm of course blanking on this, but you know, find a friend, you know, go take a breather, you know. I mean, nobody is going to be upset for you for taking care of yourself. And honestly, there are so many people who have, you know, sensory problems, that have anxiety, that have, you know, ADD, you know, that get into cosplay. I feel like it is such an outlet for a lot of us that you will be amazed that when you're having a conversation with somebody, you're like, I'm sorry, I'm just like super anxious. I'm really interested in what you have to say. Like, I just need a moment for myself. Oh yeah, I have that same problem. You know, I mean, it's just, it's been such a fantastic experience for both of us.
I don't necessarily suffer from social anxiety or anything like that. Being the MC, I very much am an extrovert. I love talking to people. That's never really been much of an issue for me. I tend to go more inward a lot of times. I have a lot more of a central grappling sphere. And if I get anxious or if I get depressed or anything like that, it tends to pretty much just focus on me. That's it. But I was talking with we were the other friends there, and we were talking, and 2020 was a nightmare. Let's just leave it at that. We were talking about the effect of 2020 and what it had on the convention scene, on the cosplay scene, on the individual level, and it's still, the effects of it are still being felt. But when 2020 happened, it was very up and down here for me personally, as well as for everything on the convention scene, like the cosplay and everything, so that all just kind of snowballed into one giant personal problem, and I didn't know how to really deal with it. And so honestly, from 2020 till realistically probably late last year, early this year, I have a two-bedroom apartment, and I converted my second bedroom into my craft room. And for a long while, I had my second bedroom. I didn't even open the door. I didn't even go in the craft room, because looking at it and knowing it was on the other side, just trying to wrap my head around working on a project and going to a convention and doing all that stuff and everything just seemed so out of the realm of possibility to me for so long. For a while, I literally didn't go in there for at least over a year. That door never opened. And I finally, when I was ready to even start thinking about getting back in, I was like, what am I going to do? I just need to start doing it. I just need to do something. And so I went in and I tidied up for like an hour, didn't work on anything. Just went in, tidied up, cleaned up, closed the door, left. Went in a few months later and everything. Finished tidying up, finished organizing and stuff, vacuumed, left. And I didn't even actually start working on projects again until realistically probably November or December of last year. And then now starting again this year.
Well,
and
I didn't know what to do with it, and got any Buffy fans in here, but Buffy the Vampire Slayer, I was like, make an okay Willow cosplay. So I kind of merged Dark Willow and Vamp Willow because they both, in the comics as well, like they both have the like Bored Now. So I put Bored Now across a t-shirt in Buffy paint, wore black jeans with it, and put on that wig. And then of course we got the mask still. Two people got it. So I like, once again, like I said, you know, no matter how niche it is, you might, somebody came up and they're like, is that Willow? Yes. But you know, it was just trying to find something that wasn't, all my cosplays are winter cosplays, but anyway, sorry.
But the moral of that story where I was going was, I'm glad that I took those steps and I'm glad that I took the time that I needed to do what I needed to do to get ready to start going. But I really do enjoy it because I do love the concept of meeting fantastic people and having those experiences and everything. But everybody has their own journeys that they have to do. Everyone has their own start points and stuff. And, you know, I met one of the women who had, have you guys seen the show?
No.
Kind of, at least sort of. So it's an animated show. The premise is several of them have very long movies. I met a group at C2E2 only because I happened to be wandering the floor and I had a friend sitting on my leg and I literally saw one of their giant weapons up above the crowd because they were holding it like on their shoulder. And so I just saw this giant scythe. And I just see this giant scythe just bobbing as they're walking. And I could see like when they would turn, the scythe would turn. And I just kind of saw it bobbing and I'm like, I don't know who that is, I'm gonna go make a friend.
Well, we have safe friends with them. And sadly enough, Crescent Rose is the name of her weapon.
Yes.
And it.
Just recently.
Yes, it broke. Okay. And Asen.
Yes.
In a very epic way, though. They were doing a slow-mo video, and it broke in the video. And it was just, it's so sad that it broke, but it is so amazing that they got it on video. It was so sad for Danielle. She said she needed to remake it for a while.
I had a giant hammer that I made that ended up falling off the back of a car, and amazingly it survived. It just like, I had it in two main pieces, the handle and the big part, the actual head of the hammer, and the handle just came out. So I ended up just holding the handle onto it and then keeping the hammer part on my shoulder the entire rest of the convention. It was, have you ever played or seen anything related to like Resident Evil 8? Like,
oh.
Carl Heisenberg.
Okay, okay.
So like just,
yeah.
Dude with a giant hammer.
Yep.
And I was so tired on my way home that I didn't realize that my hammer was on the car, one, and two, it had fallen off, and the person I was with did not notice either. So
he had a sword break at C2E2 and had to cancel a photo shoot.
Yeah.
Yikes.
He was a cosplay photographer though, and he was very, very,
he was
very underserved. Dustin!
Yeah, I mean, that's, and then I think that's the point of it all, is first off, like Sir said, everybody, I can guarantee you the vast majority of anybody in the cosplay scene, whoever you're talking to probably has some form of anxiety or, you know, something along those lines. Everybody is self-conscious in some way. But that's one of the things of cosplay is doing it helps you overcome some of those barriers that you feel because
it gives you a connection.
You do. It's a connection to the fandom and it's also a connection, and when you're in cosplay, you're allowed to not feel 100% like yourself. Or for some people, it's the exact opposite. When you're in cosplay, you feel more like yourself than you do when you're in your work uniform. Just to be 95%.
Honestly, I was just looking through my notes actually for, you know, this panel that, you know, when I first started doing it. And one of the other things that I kind of brought up kind of goes along with that, like other people are very rarely going to notice your mistakes or ever bring them up. So
if they do, they aren't cosplayers.
No, they're jerks. They're gatekeepers and they're jerks. So just an example that I will come up here before Planet Funk. I did these like a week before. I did them backwards. Oops. If you look at, and I was so upset. And it was also my second. So he's like, just mirror the photo. Just if you're going to do a side by side, he's like, nobody will notice. I met two Vanellope cosplayers that thought their pants were backwards because mine were. And I'm like, nope, it was me. Mine are backwards. Nobody has given a crap. Nobody has even noticed unless I pointed it out. Or like I said, I am next to another Vanellope cosplayer who's are accurate.
Man, if somebody had told you that it wasn't that big of a deal.
But honestly, see, last Planet Funk 2, once again, Baroness, who is, like I said, just a fabulous person. If you're not following her, you should be. She she's got the picture down there, but she actually had the cosplay there. She was in the Crown Championships, and she's got just this fantastic Zach
Fisher, was that
Zach Fisher? Yeah, armor. And I'm looking at it. Oh my god, that is just so amazing. Like, up close, you know, I haven't seen it up close, and she said, we are looking at two different things. I am looking at every little mistake that I made, and you're looking at it going, oh my god, that's cool. And I'm like, oh my god. I'm like, I never, like I said, she's become a good friend. I mean, she's a great person, and I'm so happy that she was able to do this show. And, when we took over, we kind of inherited the cosplay contest and stuff for this after, you know, because COVID kind of happened and they went through, you know, okay, well, the person that was supposed to run the cosplay is no longer, you know, doing this, so hey, do you guys want to? So he asked me if I knew her, and he's like, I've had several people, you know, ask about her, and, you know, she said that when Marcus told her that, she was like, well, she said it made her feel so good. But I mean, it's just that impact that you make on people sometimes that you don't realize. But I mean, like, honestly, like I said, I know about half the people in this room are, you know, our cameraman back here, Eric, fantastic guy. You know, we met through QuadCon, such a supportive, wonderful person. His panels are so interesting. Travis, we met through another Ruby group. He has helped us out a lot with QuadCon. He said these two have stepped up. That's another thing. If you are interested in, you know, doing more with cosplay and being more involved, all Josh did was say to Don Wells, hey, I'm really interested in this. How can I be a part? And we've gone from being a very minor part to being a major part because we've lost a lot of people over there. We can always use extra people, you know, and just...
The other thing I just want to touch on before we go on everything, so I know we've talked a little bit about the project, we've talked about like creating cosplays and stuff like that, but I want to emphasize, cosplay is cosplay.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
it doesn't
yes.
matter if you buy all your stuff, it doesn't matter if you make all your stuff. Now, if we're talking about
yes.
Then there is the material.
That is the only time that it makes a difference. Passing something that you know, made off or didn't make off. Other than that, yeah.
But if you're just showing up to show off, if you want to cosplay, it doesn't matter how you start. It doesn't matter what you start with. If you buy a full Captain America suit online and you want to go to the Marvel convention, have it last.
Honestly, so another just fantastic cosplay duo we know, the cosplay was supposed to be here, but unfortunately COVID happened and they've got a lot of, you know, other commitments. They've got an international thing going on. Well, Elle, the one half, she has posted a lot lately about how when they're just attending cons a lot of times, or even sometimes guesting but not competing, they will buy things now because they don't have the time to make things for not competition. And she said at first it felt so weird, but now it's kind of freeing. And I never thought about it like that. But I mean, it is true. Like, I mean, don't feel like you are any less than somebody that, and if somebody, like you said, if somebody
judges you because, oh, I made this and blah, 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 you know, that's not okay. That we had this huge jerk come up at the very first, yes. So he is up doing a panel at the first QuadCon that we were involved with, and I honestly just kind of pulled in because we needed the help, and I was there because I was just a sidekick, and kind of how Travis got pulled in. And he just showed up to say, see us, and I'm like, hey, I'm down to judge, and then we started with the cosplay medic. I mean, it's just helping each other, but I was manning the table while he was doing that, and this dude comes up, and he's looking at his gauntlets. He's not even in cosplay, and he's like, oh, well, he could have done this better, and he could have done this better, and I'm like, this was his first, you know, and I had, you know, Blake's weapon there, and I kind of pulled it a little closer to me because I'm like, I don't want you to, well, and then I've had somebody tell, like, look at my weapon and go, oh, well, it looks okay, but it's supposed to be a lot longer and thinner. I'm 5'1". Like he was saying about the people, yeah, and Skylar did he was saying about, you know, our friend with the huge spike, because she and her best friend have massive weapons because they're like 5'10", 5'11". You have to make it would look weird. I mean, Travis just talked about this yesterday. We were talking about that too. It would look weird if I had a giant weapon because I'm little. I made it to, like, I did everything on that. I looked at the specifications and we looked at how big it can be. I made the, you know, I patterned it. I did all that stuff. It was honestly my only homework so far. But I was appalled. I'm like, you know what? Why would you criticize somebody else's stuff? I mean, either don't say anything or compliment people. If you have nothing nice to say, don't say anything at all.
Like, if you're not actively judging a competition, do not give
unsolicited, yeah.
Like, if someone asks you directly, like, yes. Oh, hey, what do you think I could have done better on this?
Yes.
That is when you go, oh, I saw this and this.
Yeah.
And you can do this.
Or I saw that you have a cosplay like this. I am trying to, you know, you reached out to, so neither of us are super great with wings. And once again, it was Mom, Marshall. She was trying to talk us through how to do a wing over Facebook Messenger as she was coming to C2E2. And it was hilarious. And we went with it, but he actually reached out to a different cosplayer that did a foam wig. And we've never really done anything with it, or you haven't, but I mean, you started kind of patterning, but you know, that's okay. You know, being like, oh, hey, I saw you did this, and I'm kind of trying to do something similar, but you know, once again, like you said about, you know, just people. So Dustin here, so he and I followed each other in like a mass following before C2E2. And it's just so funny because, you know, we met up and he asked me, you know, he's like, oh, hey, is this you? And I'm like, yeah. And then later on, I'm talking to a couple other people and we're like, oh, let's follow each other on social. And I'm like, oh, we already are, you know? But it's just, it's so fun to like meet some of those people that you have been following and stuff too. 90% of the time, if you know, hit somebody up on social that you're like, oh, so you're gonna be at this con. Hey, do you wanna meet up or whatever? You know, I have had so many people, and it's just so fun. I mean, it really is. It's just such a wonderful, welcoming community. I mean, there are those bad eggs, but yeah, as I say, there are those bad eggs. And there are so many more.
It has gotten a lot better over the past decade.
It has,
like,
yeah.
When I started, I was, I think, 12.
Oh,
now
wow.
I'm 24.
So, yeah, see, I got started late.
Yeah, it's that's another thing is you really need to protect the young people in cosplay circles because I ended up like developing an eating disorder because of cosplay and because of the comments I got and because of all of the things that people were saying. And now I'm finally like getting to be a little more okay with my body and wearing cosplay with my body. But because of those comments I got at a young age, that like really messed up my brain.
Our society just as a whole, I mean, we do so much body shaming for any body type. It is not okay to body shame somebody for being thin. I mean, there are people, and I see some nods from a tall, thin person. I know so many skinny people that are like, I want to be bigger. I eat, and nothing happens. And then, you know, people are, I mean, I get really mad sometimes online. You know, I will see somebody, obviously, Aaron and I were just talking about this last night. We both had very, very bad experiences in the last couple of years with groups that were actually the opposite, bigger people. I got told that I was not bad enough to have an opinion in a group on Facebook that I thought would be welcoming, and I was a small head. And, well, you know, that's fine, you can be in our group, but, you know, both of us got this weird comment about Victoria's Secret. Oh, it must be nice to be able to wear Victoria's Secret. It must be nice to be able to, you know, you can't have a comment, you can't have a voice here because you can buy clothes in a normal store. We are both what's considered probably mid-size. Neither of us are big enough to actually be considered plus size in, like, the modeling community. I mean, I feel like cosplay, I'm probably, you know, still kind of in between. I mean, I carry my weight well, I'll say. I'm just kind of, nobody ever thinks I weigh as much as I do, but, it's
call
just,
that Iowa size. We like it better, though.
But you know what I mean, though. It's just, I'm like, okay, I never expected
body
that.
Body acceptance.
Yes.
Are.
Well, and I never expected that.
I'm never
that.
Going to be smaller. I'm never going to be a jock. Okay? You know?
Well,
I was never going to be pretty.
there's a lot of unnecessary standards, and they change over the years anyway. So even if one person is conventionally attractive, like, say, 5, 10, 15 years ago, they would not be considered conventionally attractive today if they wore the same outfits and styled themselves the same way.
Mm-hmm.
So,
well, and just the body shape, the body type. I mean, if you look back at, like,
if you're not kind of careful about picking your great grandparents, right? You'll end up just looking like
yeah.
you are, right? You know?
Yeah. Genetics.
There you go.
I mean, you will look at pictures of, like, Renaissance paintings of these, you know, voluptuous women, and now we expect everybody to be, like, stick thin. And the thing is, those models and half those cosplayers don't look like they do in those. There's a, oh my gosh, she is so, so tiny. You were right. Pandora, she's another just fantastic, sweet, awesome cosplayer that we have met, that we both followed for a long time. She is very, very, has a lot of problems, and she's also just as sweet as could be, but she was very open about it on her Instagram. She had gotten an antidepressant and gained some weight, and she's like, just want to be completely honest, I have photoshopped some of this stuff because I am not comfortable with the weight I've gained. And I was very sad for her that, you know, that was how she felt, but I feel like if that's what she needed to do to make herself feel good, that's fine. She wasn't trying to do it, you know, to fool anybody or anything. It was just, you know, I mean,
it wasn't to deceive anyone.
Yeah.
It was to feel comfortable in sharing
yeah,
the art
yeah.
that she
and
already
I,
created.
Mm-hmm.
Because
yeah,
sometimes,
so.
You know, you don't feel comfortable
mm-hmm.
with how you look just right out of the bag, as it were. So if you want to share your stuff, share something you feel comfortable with and just be honest about it.
Mm-hmm. Did you have anything else? Did anybody have any questions or
comments?
I mean, you know, like I said, it's pretty informal.
I know for me, being a big guy, it's actually, I have fun because I do a lot of things that you don't see.
Oh, yeah, no, I love your cosplay.
So, I actually try to find characters that work with my license.
Mm-hmm.
You're never going to see me walking around in a Spider-Man suit. It's, it's really hard to find morph suits in 5X.
So. Honestly, though, I mean, so he's got a Red Lantern cosplay, and he's not big by any means. He does not wear that because he will. That's actually something that's come up this weekend, too. So, once again, Baroness. Her husband is Noah Smith Photography, and he was unable to be here this weekend because of his 9-to-5 job, but he took pictures of Josh at one of the C2E2s, and Josh came up to him, I think, at the last C2E2, and I was like, hey, dude, I'm really sorry. Yeah, I'll let you. It's your
I apologize to him because I costume once, only once.
Is a skin tight body suit. I'll just say that.
Anybody who wears Batman suits, Spider-Man suits, anything skin tight whatsoever, I give you so much props because I am not used to the material. So the Red Lantern that I was cosplaying is Guy Gardner. I'm almost familiar with the Lantern Corps thing. He's a third generation Lantern, and he has a different color. He is a little bit more of a, they call him like the rock star Lantern, because he actually starts as a Green Lantern and ends up becoming a Red Lantern because he gets pissed off at the Green Lantern Corps for not doing their jobs. And he has like a jacket that goes over his normal Lantern suit, and he has like these like rocker boots and everything that he would go with him. And I love him also because he's redhead. And I did buy a wig because my hair is not as red as when I was a kid, but the suit, for starters, when I first put it on, I asked several people about the Spider-Man cosplays and everything. I haven't been a theater, I haven't been a dancer. I discovered what the dancer's belt is. I never wanted to know what the dancer's belt is.
Yes, if you're a male and have a skin tight costume on, you need a dancer.
So that was uncomfortable piece number one, that we just tossed that one over. And so then I have this skin tight suit that I'm already getting better at trying to get to the gym, each other kind of motivate to, you know, are you going to the gym today? I'm not really sure. Okay, we're going to the gym. But I'm getting better and I'm feeling a little bit more comfortable, not comfortable enough, but we'll cross that bridge. But I had to, going down to the common floor, I consistently had to, the hotel we were staying in had like mirrored elevators, and there were several times just in the hallway to the elevator to the lobby, I had to look up and look in the mirrors to remind myself that I was actually wearing something, because the neoprene was so breezy, it felt like all I had on was this dancer's belt and this jacket. And I was like, no, there are clothes. There's clothes? Yeah, there's clothes, okay, good. They're still, yeah, no, they're still there. We're good. Okay.
Like the skin is covered.
And that's it. It is. It's literally from the neck down. It's a full body suit. But it was just, I'm not used to it. It was so far out of my comfort zone.
Well, he said the picture. I've never seen the picture. I don't know where we are. I don't know. Maybe you did. But he said the pictures Noah took were fantastic. Yeah. And he felt so bad. And he told him, he's like, it has nothing to do with your pictures. It has to do with
the
body.
Style of tussle or anything like that. It was just a stock wig. I was not comfortable with the bodysuit, so a lot of my poses, I posed how he asked me to pose in the pictures. I am happy with it, but because there was just so much uncomfortability all rolled into one space, it just didn't work. And so it's hanging in the closet. I still got it.
I guess one more thing that I will say is, so I'm not a creator. I do like to make my own stuff. I don't know that I will ever compete. I am definitely, I don't know how many of you are at the cosplay contest with me. I am definitely the behind the scenes person. He's the MC. But he does a lot too. We both do for QuadCon, and then we have a third, Callie Drocken here. You guys want to follow her as well. She's, I don't think she's on Insta, just Facebook. The three of us basically run the, you know, cosplay for QuadCon. Travis has been helping us a lot, Skylar and Ryan. Like I said, I mean, whatever you want out of cosplay, though. I mean, some people just want to dress up and go to a con. Some people want to actually, you know, have an Instagram presence, maybe, you know, be a guest at a con, you know, or help run something. Like I said, you know, just do, and none of it's wrong. Like you said about the making versus buying, I mean, none of it's wrong. As long as you're not trying to pass something off that you bought as that you made it to, you know, I've never understood that either. We've had so many people. I mean, QuadCon's not a huge con. I mean, it's growing, but for the most part, it's not a cash prize. It's a, honestly, I kind of like the way he does it. Yes, it's a show credit.
to any of the vendors just to kind of keep the money in the show. And we're talking about like a $50 show credit, and we have people trying to pass off stuff that they obviously didn't make. There was, you know, one that 3D printed a weapon and trying to say that he, like, I mean, I'm not that familiar with the phone. Or we had another one, we kind of rotate judges, you know, it just kind of depends. Kelly, Josh, and I are usually there. Josh usually MCs. Kelly and I judge sometimes, you know, we do the back, you know, I'm always pretty much the one doing the paperwork unless I'm not there, and then she's with Kelly. But we usually have people who have different strengths. So I definitely know more about sewing. These two are foam works. Travis was one of our judges yesterday. Aaron is another one that was Nerdwood cosplay. He, Nerdwood by Aaron, I don't know. I think he's got a couple of different handles, but he is also great with foam. We've got Rachel, who's downstairs, Melanie Ray. She is one that knows, you know, the sewing. She does crocheting, you know, so we've all got kind of our different things that we know about. And we had somebody that I'm talking to, and the girl that was with me is also more of a seamstress, and she doesn't really know. I've done a little bit of foam work, and the things that I'm asking him as we're prejudging are not adding up for me. And I'm like, as little as I know, if you made this whole big armor yourself, you should know what plastic dip is. You know, it's funny when you his answers just weren't adding up. So I kind of grabbed these two. He was on the scene, he was judging, and I said, can you talk to this guy? Because the way we were having to do it that day was we were going down the row and we weren't together. And so, yeah, they both came to me and said, no, somebody put a lot of work into that. It was not him. But I just don't understand that, though. I don't know. But that's the only time. That is the only time that it's not acceptable to.
What it boils down to is, like I said, cosplay can be whatever. Whether it's an escape for you to not feel like yourself, or whether it's exactly the opposite. To feel like yourself, you get out of it what you are willing to put into it, and it can be whatever you want it to be. And that's one of the beautiful things about it. Is if you want to start. It doesn't matter where, it doesn't matter. Just pick something, start small, start big.
And we know people, like I said, with all sorts of different. I mean, we've got the people, like I said, with me that are insane craftsmen and beautiful seamstresses that are like, oh, you know, for some shows, we're just going to buy stuff. We've got other people that they love making props, but they don't like to sew or can't sew. And they're like, okay, well, you know, I'm going to buy this costume and I'm going to make an awesome prop to go with it. And all of that, you know, any of that, whatever, mix and match. If you want to make your stuff, cool. Or if you just want to go and admire the cosplay, you know, the only thing, you know, that I will say about that, and I'm pretty sure we've got a good crew here, cosplay is not consent. Always ask before you take a picture. And respect people's space. You know, if somebody says, that's one thing, that as a cosplayer, I really try not to ever turn people down and just be, that is the only thing that I will say about it. If you're dressed up at a con, expect that somebody might ask to take a picture with you. And if you're not comfortable with that, maybe don't go as a character. I mean, you know, and I'm not trying to be mean there. And you are fully able to say no. But if I'm going to continuously turn somebody down, because that happened to you too. There was somebody that he followed, and every time, oh no, we're doing this now. Oh no, we're doing that now. And then we were like just a lot of stuff about, no, they're not very nice. They're not nice to fans. They're just not. It was horrible. They just totally had a kind of fake internet personality and didn't, you know, oh, you know, be very supportive of everybody, and they were not that way. I mean, if you're not comfortable with pictures, maybe just say that. You know, I mean, people are understanding. But if you're running to do a panel, or if you have a panel that you want to attend as a cosplayer, and you're like, hey, you know, I'm really running right now. Could we maybe catch up later? Or, you never turned out the picture.
One thing I will say, do not interrupt the cosplayer to ask them for a photo if they're eating.
Yes.
If they are eating or part of their costume is off.
Yes.
Do not do it.
Yes. No. That is definitely. I was going to say before that night.
If they are snacking with you, do not be upset with them because most of the time we have not eaten.
Yeah. I'm so bad about that.
C2E2 that first year that I it took me was an hour and a half to get to the bathroom. To literally, so like the entrance to the bathroom was like maybe from the elevator to like that far. That was it. It was that was the distance. It took me like an hour and a half between everybody. Oh, can I get a picture? Oh, can you do a photo? Can you do this? And finally, towards the end, I was just like, I had like 3 bottles of water this morning. There are no more pictures. I'm going in that bathroom. I don't care.
I will never forget. So there are probably some people out there who have a picture of a random cat girl in their X-Men photos. So Aaron has a fantastic Professor X cosplay that he did at the last WonderCon. He won at GalaxyCon, I think, and he brought a couple minutes. Yeah, that's probably about it. And then if there are any questions, but he was just bombarded by people asking for pictures, and I was kind of trying to talk to him, and I was trying to get out of the picture, and he's like, no. I was like, just step. And I'm like, and I'd already taken off my Blade cosplay. I had changed to go to the Crown Championships, but I had left my wig and my ears on because I didn't want to mess with my hair and just put a cardigan over my, like, I'd take off Blade's jacket and put a cardigan over her little, sleeveless tee. And so I always think about those people, they're probably going to be like, what X-Men is that? that's the thing too. If they want a picture and, you're monopolizing somebody's time, I guess just be aware that, they may say, well, my friend's going to be in it. So, anyway, if there are no questions, comments, I guess we'll kind of wrap up.
So just to kind of solve everything, I have a quote, any Star Trek fans? So here's the deal. I wasn't for a while. Sort of kind of. I recently found Star Trek Discovery on Paramount Plus for a good trip. But they end the series with a quote from Gene Roddenberry. And I don't normally take a lot of wisdom from stuff like that, but this quote actually came from home. I was thinking about stuff that kind of talk about this thing, and this quote really kind of hit it. Said, in a very real sense, we are all aliens on a strange planet. We spend most of our lives reaching out and trying to communicate. And if during our lifetime we could reach out and truly communicate and connect with just 2 people, we are especially fortunate. It's prosperous.
Yeah, I'm a prosper.
Yeah. I can have you all show up just mostly.
Anyway, thank you all for coming. I appreciate the discourse we have. Thank you so much.
Sonic.